You are about to see a special performance of the Boar's Head Feast. This reenactment of an old English Christmas dinner is an opportunity for us to enjoy traditional Christmas music and examine a few of the Christmas traditions that have been handed down to us from medieval times. The setting is a 13th century home of gentle people who are entertaining their friends and neighbors in the fashion of the day.
And peace be among you and through all the earth to men and women of goodwill. Tonight we are taken back in time some 700 years to welcome the Christ child to the troubled world, just as our forefathers did in England long ago. We invite you to warm your bodies against the winter with a hearty feast, but that will be just the beginning. All of us are characters in an exciting drama that unfolds here tonight. To play our parts well, we need only be ourselves. The prophet of old said the coming of Jesus would be in the fullness of time. Today, that is the message of the Boar's Head ceremony. Proclaimed in bright costumes, ancient songs, and the gaily decked wild boar, the people that walk in darkness shall see the light, the prophet said. Be yourselves then, and with us celebrate the coming of the light of the world.
Run, 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 run.
Before the feast, guests were traditionally served the wassail bowl, and soon their appetites were awakened and their feet became as light as their heads. The drink in those days was a mixture of hot ale, sugar, nutmeg, or ginger. Wealthy people added wine and highly spiced and sweetened. Legend tells us that our ancestors drank their wassail from the skulls of their enemies, and that the word wassail comes from the German was heil, meaning here's to you or to your health. And the answer always came back, trink heil. An old story says that once a fair maiden greeted a prince in that way. He, of course, had to make the usual response. He became so smitten by her beauty and the exchange of greetings that he soon married her. Now, we don't promise you the same results, but we do promise you good cheer and a toast to your health and a merry song as you sip.
Here we come a-wassailing among the leaves of green. Here we come a-wandering so fair to be seen. Love and joy come to you and to you your wassail too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year. We are not daily beggars that beg from door to door, but we are just your neighbors whom you have seen before. Love and joy come to you, and to you your wassail too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year. Call up the butler of his house, put on his golden ring. Let him bring us a glass of cheer, and better shall we sing. Love and joy come to you, and to you your wassail too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year.
The wild boar, we remember, is one to be revered as well as feared as a ferocious enemy. He became the symbol of sin and evil, banished by the coming of the light. The boar's head held the place of honor at many an English dinner. One of the traditions connected with it was for the master of the house to take an oath upon it that he would fulfill his duties for the coming year. The man given the honor of carving the head was presumed to be one of great courage and of unspotted reputation. The head is dressed in a garland of rosemary and laurel, and a lemon, symbol of plenty, is in its mouth. Bring in the boar's head, lads. Favor plum pudding, you may want to ask yourself what goes into it. The story goes that centuries ago, an English king and a party of hunters were lost in the woods on Christmas Eve. The poor cook, stuck with only the scanty provisions for a Christmas Eve meal, put everything he had into the pot and made the first plum pudding. Well, we're not lost in the woods, and our kitchen is well equipped. But it is said that the ingredients which that first cook used form the basis for the plum pudding we know today. There were some mince pies made in merry old England that were almost unbelievable. One Sir Henry Grey decided to order and was served a pie which was 9 feet across and had to be wheeled into the hall on a four-wheeled cart. Guess what was in it? The pie contained 2 bushels of flour, 20 pounds of butter, 4 geese, 2 rabbits, 4 wild ducks, 2 woodcocks, 6 snipes, 4 partridges, 2 neat's tongues, 2 curlews, 6 pigeons, 7 blackbirds, and a partridge in a pear tree. Well, it would be hard to imagine which was more obnoxious, the sight of such a pie or the taste of that mixture. But extravagance was the fashion in England for centuries.
We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Good tidings,
good tidings we bring. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
We won't go till we won't go.
We won't go till we won't go.
pie has always represented the choicest things from the East, and it symbolizes the gifts of the wise men to the Christ child. It started when the Crusaders, returning from the Holy Lands, brought back all sorts of Oriental spices with them. So it followed that the Lord's Nativity had to be celebrated with a pie containing the spices from his native land. Whether or not you are a fancier of mincemeat pie, I dare say none of you would call it a controversial dish, but that is just what it has been for many years. Mince pies were first baked in the shape of a manger, somewhat oblong. Sometimes the pie was not fully covered, but was cross-latticed, and this represented the hay rack of the stable. Often in the slight depression in the top of the pie was placed a figure of the child Jesus. In later years, after the Reformation, the Puritans started a great outcry against mince pie. Not the pie itself, of course, but its shape offended them, and the use of the figure of baby Jesus. They were convinced that to eat mince pie was idolatry and an abomination, superstitious and popish. Well, immediately Catholics and Anglicans rose to its defense, and the more the Puritans attacked the pie, the more did the others bake and eat it. Eventually, it reached the point that eating or not eating mince pie became a test of orthodoxy, whichever side you were on. The pie was even banned by government decree when the Puritans came to power. But as the battle waged on, gradually the shape of the pie was ignored, and before long, it was circular, and the figure of the child, which had caused all the fuss in the first place, had disappeared. Both sides were satisfied, so then everyone accepted the tasty pie, enjoying it with a clear conscience. Perhaps you think our historic feast a foolish excursion to a time that will never be again, but that's not so. We have tried to help you see that even 700 years ago, Christmas was a time of warmth and joy. There's something about the season which leads to extravagances, but the extravagance is in expressing love to one another. Times have changed, but love has not. The warmth of Christmas is an ever-returning thing. So we greet you, dear friends and neighbors, with the words sung by the heavenly choir. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men and women of goodwill.
Oh.
we all join in wishing you a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year. This program was recorded.